I'm asking you to leave us alone, Ben. I mean it.
Is he okay?
You don't care if he's okay. You care if he's showing.
It's my responsibility, Owen. We talked about this. When the time comes, he must be trained.
Like you trained his father?
From the world-famous Blackbird Studios, it's the Rave X Podcast. And now, Rave X.
Yo, hey now. Thanks for joining me for another episode of the Rave X Podcast. Episode 93, Kenobi Review. I'm your host, Marvin Hagler. So it's been a while, kids. Your boy Rave X has been busy, but I am hungover like crazy on a Saturday after my band played our second live show on our three-show tour that we're doing. And, you know, we had a lot of shows booked, and then, of course, you know, that virus happened that you guys might have heard of. We got to cancel a bunch of shows, so we're kind of making up all those shows now. And we played our second one yesterday. Let me tell you something, man. Your boy Rave X really hurt himself. I got to ease up. I got to start drinking a soda pop or something. I'm getting too old for this shit. But it was a blast. So in this episode, man, we're going to be reviewing the Disney Plus limited series Kenobi. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the show we played last night. Anyway, the show was really good, man. You know, we played in Central Square, Cambridge, my hometown of Central Square, Cambridge. I used to run around there stealing from all the little stores when I was a kid up to no good. So there used to be this club called the Cantab. It's still there on Mass Ave. And I would walk past it when I was 10, 11 years old, you know, and I'd see all the cool blues and rock guys in there. And I always thought, like, oh, I'd love to play in there one day. So later on, they kind of renovated the place and they had the hard rock metal shows downstairs and the bluesy jazz funk stuff upstairs. Now, I saw my buddy's band play, Horrible Earth. They're a great band. I've seen them play down there about half a dozen times, and I never thought I'd be on that stage, you know. Sure enough, we get the gig. We're playing at the Cantab downstairs. Let me just say this about the Cantab. It's a right shithole, guys. Honestly, no matter what time of year it is 117 degrees down there. And to load in, you load in through the back where the back door for all the restaurants and kitchens are. And there was just a flock, a herd, a gaggle of mentally ill drug addict homeless people back there. So we pull in. And immediately we see these homeless people that are fighting with each other, and they're half naked. Some of them are washing themselves. The other ones are passed out against the dumpster. And I said to my guitar player, well, Choose Your Power always plays the classy shows. We always play the classy shows, you know. And, you know, we come up with the plan. Look, let's not leave the cars unattended. Make sure there's someone up here. Because these homeless drug addicts were aggressive. They weren't the nice, kind ones you see on TV. Remember the old show, what was it, Mayberry with Andy Griffin, the Andy Griffin Show? You had the local wino hobo, but he was quaint, right? Sometimes he'd deal out some sage, wise advice, and then he'd get drunk and he'd turn himself into the police to sleep it off. Not these guys. These guys were aggressive. And they were fighting and they were yelling at each other. And one of them was yelling at the other one because I guess the other homeless guy wanted to borrow one of the other guy's pants. And he's like, you can't be up in here trying to start shit with me, trying to borrow someone's pants. Okay, my motherfucker, you gonna take my pants? I'm going, oh my God, I never thought at my age I would be having to deal with this to play a rock show. But we loaded in the stuff. We got there early because we're professionals. We got there before anyone else. Now, the Cantab downstairs, it's very clean. They have a great bar. It's painted. It's completely renovated. They didn't put in any AC, I guess. So we're down there. We're burning up. We set up all our stuff, man. The other bands show up. It's awesome. Next thing you know, it's time for us to go on stage for the second time in about a month and a half, 2 months. The first show at the Midway in Jamaica Plain, thanks to everyone who came out to see that. That was a good show, but that was our first show with our newer drummer, Brother John. And I didn't know how it was going to go, and it went great, right? So now we have our second show, and I'm going, was the first show, you know, a unicorn? We just got lucky? Oh, my brothers, let me tell you something. Your boys Choose Your Power tore it up from the mother effing floor up. I'm saying that without ego. I know I'm the bass player, but I'm saying that without ego. We took that stage like we was avenging our brother's death, like an old samurai avenging his brother's death, man. We were vicious. We were precise. We were aggressive. We were accurate. We were loud as F, brother. So we got up there. We plugged in. Boom. From start to finish, it was nonstop. Hard rock. Heavy metal. Goodness. Yo, Shout out to my guitar player. Shout out to my drummer. I love y'all motherfuckers, man. We're doing this forever. This is CYP for life, brother. And the crowd came, and the other bands were there right up front, man, and we're on this tiny stage. It's 179 degrees up there. Sweat is just pouring down all of us. You know, I looked at my drummer. I thought he was going to melt. I thought I was going to melt. We played with two other bands, man, and they were awesome, too. I love hearing good bands and good music. We played with a band called Rostrum. And Rostrum was just, they were feeling it, man. They were vibing it. They were all in it together, you know what I mean? And then another band came on called Able Blood. And these guys looked super aggressive. I thought they were going to get up there and be like, duh, 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 duh. And they played like music like you would hear off the soundtrack to that old cartoon, Heavy Metal. Remember Heavy Metal, that cartoon from the 80s? They were just zoning out on some stoner rock, man. But it wasn't even stoner rock. They were from New Hampshire, baby. So shout out to Rostrum and Able Blood. No doubt, Choose Your Power will be playing with you guys again. It was a great show, man. The next one, October 15th, The Jungle in Somerville. I'll see you there. And now, on to some sweet, sweet Star Wars Kenobi goodness. So I'm sure by now you guys have seen the show Kenobi on Disney Plus. You know, I was kind of late to the game because I don't like to subscribe to like 15 different streaming services, you know. So I'll do the Amazon Prime for a little bit and watch The Boys, that show The Boys. I'll switch to Disney Plus. I'll switch to the, Netflix. But I try not to pay for all these things, man. It's stupid, you know. Pay for one per month. Watch what you got to watch and get in and get out. So I just caught Kenobi. And I got to say this, man, I really, really liked it. I heard some sort of criticism of the show. I don't know why. I guess that, you know, if it's not perfect, people just crap on stuff. Let me just say this starting off. Ewan McGregor, who was first Kenobi in like, what, 2002, 2000, and, yeah, around there, right, when he first was young Kenobi with Qui-Gon Jinn as his master. Then he's middle-of-the-road Kenobi. Then he's older Kenobi. So now this picks up 10 years after he defeated Anakin Skywalker, and Anakin Skywalker becomes Vader. And what's interesting is he doesn't even know that Anakin has become Vader. He's off the grid. Kenobi's off the grid, bro. He's living on Tatooine. He's like working as kind of like a butcher or like a meat processor guy in this long conveyor belt thing. He doesn't use the Force. He's not in contact with anyone. He lives in a cave. He's really like... He's off the grid. It reminded me a lot of Luke Skywalker in The Force Awakens. He just shut himself off from the Force, you know? And he's trying to keep an eye on young Luke, you know? And he's living a very solitary life when this picks up. Now, Darth Vader wants Kenobi, but he can't let the Emperor know that. He's got to play it cool because the Emperor's like, "You must let go of your past. I don't feel that you are dedicated to the mission, Vader." And Vader's like, "Kenobi means nothing to me, you know?" But he wants Kenobi. He has not let this go in 10 years. So he sends out, Vader sends out these people called the Inquisitors. Now, if you read some of the old books, the old sort of extended universe Star Wars books, Inquisitors are kind of like, they're a step below Jedi, but above a Padawan, you know? They've got Force powers, but they go out and they hunt Jedis. So these Inquisitors are looking for Kenobi, and they go to Tatooine, and they do that thing where they're like, "We know there's a Jedi here. If you don't give us that Jedi, we're going to kill people." And they bring out Uncle Owen, who you heard at the top of the show with that sick burn to Kenobi. You know, Kenobi saying to Uncle Owen, "The boy must be trained." And he goes, "Yeah, like you trained his father." Oh, sick burn. Oh, no, he didn't. Yeah, he did, man. So the Inquisitor grabs Uncle Owen just out of the crowd. And this Inquisitor person... played by Ingram Moses, black girl, who we're going to get to. She got a lot of crap for this role. I don't know why. She says, "Hey, look, if y'all don't tell me where this Jedi is, we know he's here. I'm going to kill this dude and his family." And then eventually, you know, shit goes south. So they're looking for Kenobi big time, right? And you have this Inquisitor who's called the Third Sister. Now, she's the sort of bottom of the three Inquisitors. She wants to be the top. She's a little aggressive. Spoiler alert. There's going to be tons of spoilers for this. You find out that this this black woman, Moses Ingram, or Ingram Moses, she was one of the little kids at the Jedi Academy who Anakin kills. Remember from Revenge of the Sith when Natalie Portman says, "Anakin, you killed younglings." And he's like, "I did what I had to do." She was one of the little girls there who Anakin kills when he goes full dark side, but she survives. She survives, she heals, she wants revenge, man. It's been like 15 years maybe of her, 10 years of her waiting to get revenge on Anakin, because she says, she gives a speech towards the end where she says, I watched him come in and kill my friends and kill the only family that I knew, and I laid there and I played dead as he slaughtered my friends and family around me. I played dead until he left, and I felt the life force of my friends and families go cold. So that's who that character is. They call her Third Sister. She's hunting Kenobi. Eventually, she kind of figures out where Kenobi is, right? And for her to move up the ranks of Inquisitors, she kills the Grand Inquisitor. And she goes to Vader and kneels, and she's like, Vader, I know where Kenobi is, dude. And Vader's like, you have served me well, Grand Inquisitor. And he puts the pin on her chest, and now she's the Grand Inquisitor. But remember, this is all part of her plan. She wants to get close to Vader to kill him. And the only reason why she's hunting Kenobi is because she knows when she finds Kenobi, Vader's going to come out, and then maybe she can get in there and kill him, you know? It's all a plan, man. So now the Empire is hot on the trails of Obi-Wan Kenobi, man. He's got to duck and dodge and watch who he talks to and stuff. And, you know, like I said at the top of the show, you hear that scene where Kenobi sees Uncle Owen, and he's just telling him, like, hey, man, how's Luke? I just want to know how Luke is. And, of course, Uncle Owen, played again by Joel Edgerton. Now, Joel Edgerton was the actor from Revenge of the Sith when you see Kenobi hand off Luke to Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru. Same actors came back, Joel Edgerton and Bonnie Peacey, which was really cool. I guess there's something with Star Wars, which is like, if you play a role in Star Wars and they ask you to come back 10, 15, 20 years later, you kind of have to do it, you know? So he's talking to him, and Kenobi just wants to check in with him, but Uncle Owen isn't too happy with Kenobi because he always brings the heat, you know what I mean? Wherever Kenobi is, you know there's going to be a stormtrooper like, we're looking for a Jedi, have you seen him? So it's kind of a pain in the ass to everyone else, so people don't like Kenobi, really. They blame Kenobi for the reason why Anakin is Darth Vader now. He's like a black sheep, you know? Wherever Kenobi goes, they're like, dude, get out of here. Anyway, there's a subplot here where Bail Organa, the adopted father of Princess Leia, because remember her name was Leia Organa because she was adopted, they send a message to Kenobi saying, hey, look, somebody kidnapped Princess Leia. We don't know where she is, and we really need your help. Like, help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi, you're our only hope. And you see the most adorable thing I've seen in Star Wars since Baby Yoda. You see little, like, 9-10-year-old Princess Leia. And I don't know, I can't remember who the actress was, tiny little Princess Leia, and she's badass, dude. She's rebellious, she's tenacious, she's smart, she's fiery, she's a natural-born leader at 10 years old, you know? And it was such a heartfelt tribute to the late Carrie Fisher, because they cast this little girl, and the attitude, the mentality of this girl, you can see how she grows up to be Princess Leia. You know, there's a great scene in the first Star Wars movie where she grabs a gun out of Luke's hand and she goes, well, somebody's going to save our butt. And she starts shooting at the stormtroopers, you know. And then, of course, in the later movies that came out in the past couple of years, Princess Leia becomes General Leia, and she's the leader of the resistance. She's old now. She's 62, 63, and she's still badass, man, you know. But you see Princess Leia at 10 years old, and they kidnap her. Anyway, Kenobi goes to rescue her, and I thought she was only going to be in it for a couple of episodes. She's in the whole thing. Kenobi goes. He finds Princess Leia, and at first, young Leia doesn't know who Kenobi is. You know, he doesn't want to tell the story about her father and how he cut her father's arms and legs off and left him to die, and he's just saying, hey, look, I'm a friend. I'm here to help. I'm a Jedi. And young Leia goes, if you're a Jedi, how come you're not using any powers? And he goes, I can't use any powers right now, or they'll know I'm a Jedi. And she goes, how do I know you're not with the kidnappers? And she runs away, and Kenobi has to find her. And eventually, Princess Leia falls off a roof, and she's hanging by a wire, and she's screaming for Kenobi. And Kenobi's like, Leia, hold on. And it's the first time he's used his Jedi powers in like 10 years, man. He reaches his hand out, and the cable snaps. And young Leia falls 80, 90 feet to her death. Only right before she hits the ground, Kenobi's force power kicks in, and she lands gently on the ground. And Kenobi runs down there, and she looks up at him, and she goes, you really are a Jedi. And he's like, yes, that's what I've been trying to tell you, youngling. and she hugs him, and they become like great, great friends. The only problem with this is, in the 1978 Star Wars, when she sends him that message, you know, that iconic message where she's kneeling in front of R2-D2, and she says, "Kenobi, we need your help. You fought alongside my father in the Clone Wars. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope." When they do meet again, it's not like, "Oh, it's great to see you again. I remember when I was 10 and you saved my life from the kidnap." It's kind of weird because they're just like, "Oh, hey, what's up? I'm Princess Leia." And he's like, "I'm Kenobi. How you doing?" So, you know, you got to kind of take it that it's not, it doesn't go with the canon of Star Wars. But nonetheless, it's an amazing, amazing thing that we get to see. You know, Obi-Wan Kenobi and a young Princess Leia and this sort of bond that they made, you know. And when it's all over and Kenobi leaves her, he brings her back to Bail Organa, to her family. And they have a moment together. And he says to her, "Leia, you're fiery and you're tenacious and you're strong-willed. And you get that from your father. But you are also a beautiful, kind, gentle human being who doesn't give up on people. And you get that from your mother, both of which were amazing human beings," you know. And he doesn't say, "Your dad became Darth Vader, Space Hitler." He just goes on letting her know, man, and telling her the sort of lineage that she comes from. And she possesses both the qualities. Oh, man, it was so awesome. Now, I want to touch on the actress who played the third sister, like I talked about, the Inquisitor, Ingram Moses. Now, she just got a lot of racist crap. Apparently, there are some people out there that don't like black people to be in Star Wars. There were some people that said her acting was bad, the character was bad. This character by itself could have been its own story. You know, one of the younglings who was there when Anakin went crazy, who lived and came back to get revenge. Now, she has a fight with Kenobi. And Kenobi tries to tell her, "Hey, look, we both want the same thing. We both want Vader dead," because he finds out she's got some knowledge that Kenobi goes, "There's only one way you could have known that. You must have been," and then he has a flashback to Anakin coming in and sparking up that lightsaber and killing younglings. And she breaks down in tears and she goes, "He killed us all, man. And where were you, Kenobi? Where were you when Anakin Skywalker was killing younglings?" And Kenobi starts to cry. He's like, "Damn, you know, I tried. I'm sorry. I couldn't be everywhere, you know." And she's like, "I want revenge against Vader." And Kenobi's like, "I do too." And she looks at Kenobi and she goes, "Do you, Obi-Wan? Do you really want to kill him? Because I don't think you can bring yourself to kill him, can you?" And Kenobi has that realization, man, when they were on Mustafar, Kenobi couldn't bring himself to kill him. So, they end up fighting. The third sister and Kenobi. Of course, Kenobi beats her, and he just says, like, "Hey, look, dude, stop it. It's done, whatever." She then goes on, and she has a fight with Vader. She's waiting for the right moment to strike Vader. She meets up to Vader to say, "I've got Kenobi. He's in there. We know where he's at." Vader's like, "You have done well." And Vader turns his back, and then you hear, "Psh!" She fires up her red lightsaber and she goes to strike Vader, man. But Vader ain't having it, baby. You can't sneak up on Vader. He turns around and he freezes her in place with the Force. And he says, "You didn't think that I was going to fall for this, did you, youngling?" And it turns out Vader knew the whole time what her plan was, man. And her eyes just get big and he goes, "You could not hide your thoughts from me." You know, and he takes her lightsaber out of her hand and shit, and he breaks it in half, and now he's got two lightsabers, and they fight, you know what I mean? He gives her half the lightsaber to fight with, and she's just no match for Vader, bro. At one point, he's not even using a lightsaber. He's just using his hand to throw her around the field and stuff. Eventually, he's done playing with her, stabs her in the chest, and what the director of this did, he sort of does a double sort of thing, you see him stab her when she was a kid and then stab her when she was an adult. Like, it's happening all over again, man. And she's on her knees. Then you see the Grand Inquisitor come in, who she thought she had killed him. And he walks in and he's alive and he goes, "Hello, third sister. It appears that a desire for revenge is great motivation to keep one alive." And she's like, "Oh my God," she's bleeding out. And he goes, "We will leave you where we found you. In the gutter." Like, him and Vader turn around and walk off, and they just leave her there, you know. She finds a communicator. And the communicator is from Bail Organa. And it says, Kenobi, we think that Vader's coming to Tatooine where Luke is, his son. Be careful. And she's like, what? So you don't see her for like an episode or two. She heals. And she decides, if I can't kill Vader, I'm going to go kill his son. And that's when she goes to Tatooine. And Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru are like, she's coming, let's get ready. They fight her off. Luke runs. The Inquisitor's sister takes off after Luke, but she can't bring herself to kill a man. When she sees a 10-year-old Luke Skywalker laying there unconscious, because she like pushes him off a mountain, she fires up her lightsaber and she goes to kill him. And then she sees in her head Anakin Skywalker fire up his lightsaber and kill the kids. And she can't do it, man. It's a good move. It shows you that she's not all evil, man. She was holding in all of this anger and hatred and desire for revenge. And at the very end, like most people do, man, she finds out that that ain't going to do nothing, man. It ain't going to bring her friends back. It ain't going to make her feel better. So Kenobi runs to the farm with Uncle Owen. They're looking for Luke. They're like, Luke, where are you? Kenobi says, check over there. Oh, and I'll check over here. And then they see in the distance, man. They see the third sister Inquisitor walking with unconscious Luke in her arms. And she gets to Kenobi and Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru. And she kneels down. And she presents them with Luke, who doesn't have a scratch on him. And she says, I couldn't do it. I couldn't bring myself to do it. And Uncle Owen takes the kid and they run off. And then she has some words with Kenobi. And she looks at Kenobi and she goes, am I like him? Am I a killer, a murderer like him? And Kenobi looks at her and he goes, no, you're better than him because you didn't do it. And she looks at Kenobi and goes, what am I going to do now? And Kenobi says, he puts his hand on his shoulder and he says, that is up for you to decide. She takes her red lightsaber and she throws it away and Kenobi turns and walks away. They never tell you what happens with the third Inquisitor sister. They just leave her on the desert planet. I think we're going to see her again in whatever Star Wars thing comes up. But it's, you know, Star Wars is about redemption. In Revenge of the Sith, Queen Amidalia says to Kenobi, there's still good in him. And in fact, you find out, you know, years later, there was still good in him. The third sister, there was still good in her, man. And that's what Star Wars is about. So we get to the very end of the series. Princess Leia is back where she needs to be. Luke Skywalker is back where he needs to be. And the interesting thing about this whole Kenobi series is it can't change anything, right? Because we know what happens at Star Wars. That's the only problem with anything they do that happens before the 1978 Star Wars is we know what happens. We know that young Princess Leia wasn't going to die. We know that the third Inquisitor sister wasn't going to kill Luke. We know that, but the director of this and the show writers, they managed to make it still sort of that, it's still intriguing and it still sucks you in, man, you know? So at the end, we see Kenobi's about to ride off, and Uncle Owen says thank you, but Uncle Owen is still mad, because if it wasn't for Kenobi, none of this shit would have happened, right? And he's like, okay, you know, Kenobi takes one last look at a young Luke Skywalker, and he gets on his little camel horse thing to ride off, and Uncle Owen finally comes around, and he says, Kenobi! And he says, yes, Owen. And he goes, would you like to meet the boy? And you see Ewan McGregor's face just kind of light up a bit. And Ewan McGregor walks over to the 10-year-old Luke Skywalker, and he kind of gets down on one knee, and he says the classic line. He says, hello there. And Ewan McGregor is so amazing. I mean, the times that Ewan McGregor has to be stoic, the times that he has to be fearful, the times that he has to be remorseful, he does such a great job of conveying all of these emotions. And, you know, in this whole series, he meets Vader twice. He meets him quick one time when Vader comes down and he feels Kenobi's there. And Kenobi feels that Vader's there and he comes out to face him. And Kenobi hasn't seen Vader since he left him burning on that planet. And he's like, holy shit, you know, and Vader's like, Kenobi. And he's like, Anakin. And Vader says, Kenobi, do you plan to destroy me? And Kenobi's like, I will do what I must, you know. And they have words and stuff. And Kenobi doesn't have his powers the first time that they meet, you know? So Vader just throws him around and he, like, makes something explode that's flammable and he drags Kenobi through the fire and he says, you will feel the same pain that I did. And Kenobi's all burnt up and then someone saves him. They meet again and it's a full-on battle, man. And Kenobi has his powers back, and he's throwing rocks at Vader, and Vader says, "Your strength has returned." And they're going at it back and forth, and they sort of split it up, a sort of show a cut between Vader and Anakin, you know, training. And they keep showing back and forth to a young Anakin fighting with Kenobi, and now the older Kenobi and Anakin fighting as Vader, you know. Kenobi says to Vader, "It's because you want to win so much. Like, all you're thinking about is winning, winning, winning. And that's why you lose," because Anakin thought he had the upper hand on him. Of course, Kenobi trips him and, you know, takes his lightsaber from him. And Kenobi has this great line that he says to Anakin back in the day. He goes, "As long as your only focus is to win, Anakin, a Padawan you shall always be." And Anakin kind of like goes like, "Yeah, okay." So when they meet again now, it's just on. There's this great scene, man. You've seen it in the trailer. I'll put up a picture if you're looking at this on the YouTube. Kenobi is just sick of Anakin slash Darth Vader's crap, and he doesn't want to kill him, but he's done with his shit, bro. Then he just like spins around in a circle and cuts half his mask open. And the great thing is, you know what? I'm going to play a clip. You can hear Anakin's voice going in and out of the Darth Vader voice and the Anakin Skywalker voice, where he's still a human. And the look on Kenobi's face, he's got tears streaming down his face, man, you know. And Kenobi's just like, "Anakin, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry for all of it." And you hear Anakin with half his Vader mask cracked open go, "You did not kill Anakin. It was me." I'm going to play a clip, man. Let's go to it.
"Anakin. Anakin's gone. I am what remains.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Anakin. For all of it.
I am not your failure, Obi-Wan. You didn't kill Anakin Skywalker. I did. The same way I will destroy you."
"Then my friend is truly dead." "Goodbye, Darth."
Wow. I'm almost speechless, man. I love Star Wars so much. Hearing Ewan McGregor say to him, "I'm sorry, man." And you know, hearing Anakin say, like, "I am not your failure." There's almost that little bit of, like, he's telling him, "Don't blame yourself, Kenobi." You know, he doesn't want to say it because he still has to be the badass Vader, you know. But he's telling him, you know, "Try not to blame yourself for this, dude, because you didn't kill him. I did," meaning Vader killed Anakin. And if you remember in the 1978 Star Wars, when Luke says, "What happened to my father?" to old Alec Guinness Kenobi, he says, "He was struck down and killed by an evil Jedi named Darth Vader." Well, now you know where it came from, you know. There's also a little nice wink and a nod there, because when they do meet on the Death Star, and Vader says, "When last we met, I was but a learner, but now I am the master." And Kenobi says, "Only a master of evil, Darth." People always said, like, well, why'd they call him Darth? Like, Darth is a title. It's like saying Senator Johnson. Your first name isn't Senator, but you can call him that. And people always would say, you know, why'd you call him Darth? So this being the last time they would see each other for another, say, 10, 11 years, he says, "Well, then my friend is truly dead. You know, goodbye, Darth." You know, wow. So all in all, man, the Kenobi series was dope. I don't know why people are hating on it. I don't know why people were hating on the black actress who played the Inquisitor, Ingrid Moses. She did a good job. Ewan McGregor should get an award of some kind for this. You know, having the guy who played Anakin Skywalker come back. What was his name? Hayden Christensen. Having him come back. Having the Uncle Owen Aunt Beru actors come back, it really sort of rounds out the universe. You know, they didn't have to recast anyone. And just that scene, you know, hearing his voice go in and out between, you know, the soft voice of Anakin and the dark voice of Vader. It, you see the dichotomy, the two people in there fighting to come out, you know. And it would be another, what would be, you know, 25 years later before he finally picks up the Emperor and throws him down that chute, and then looks at his son and just, you know, you get that redemption arc. So for Anakin Skywalker, it's like a 35-year redemption arc, but you do get it. And this show fills in a lot of the gaps of what happened between Revenge of the Sith and Star Wars Return of the Jedi. I loved it, man. Go out and see it. I'm going to give the Kenobi series a solid, baby, 8 out of 10. Woo! I loved it. Well, hey, man, thanks for tuning in to the Rave X Show. We just got another subscriber, 101 subscribers. I love it. Click like, subscribe, share it with a friend, man. Follow me on the Facebook, baby, facebook.com/ Rave X Music. And as always, you want to download this show, take it with you on a run, on a jog, on a hike, and why wouldn't you? RaveXMusic.bandcamp.com. That's right, RaveXMusic.bandcamp.com. And until next time, kids, remember this. Should I say it in the Kenobi voice? Okay, remember this. In the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. My name's Rave X. Enjoy yourself.
That was the Rave X Podcast. Be sure to click like and subscribe. For podcasts, new music, and all things Rave X, go to youtube.com and search Rave X Music.